stage, please welcome Antu Lasserre, Head of IT Innovation at Michelin. Welcome her, please. Please welcome also Patrice Villomé, Head of Digital Growth and Innovation at Airbus. Patrice. And Benoît Perrin, Chief Operation Officer at EasyMile. Thank you all for being here this morning. It's a pleasure to have you here on stage. All right, so transport in all its dimension is a wide preoccupation for all big cities we know. We're in Toulouse. When we say Toulouse, we think Airbus, of course, but other major companies have been addressing this theme of transportation in the future. We think about Renault, of course, and the autonomous vehicle. We actually speak more and more about urban mobility, drones, flying taxis, etc., etc. Capgemini is currently working on these with its client, and we have decided this morning to invite some of them to tell us precisely what, according to them, is the future of transportation. What are they currently working on that matter? So I have general questions and then more individual questions, and then we'll open the questions with the audience. My first question, the idea of autonomous vehicle is great, of course, to everyone, but we tend to forget that it's been 20 years almost that we do not have any more drivers in some metro, in some cities. We're very ecstatic about the Hyperloop, and it's been ages that Japanese people have been commuting on a very far-speed train, a 700 miles an hour high-speed train on a magnetic ground. So my first question to you all is, transportation of the future, what is the part of real versus magic? Who wants to start? Ladies first.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. I think future of transportation is necessarily sustainable. Because when you look at the figures, by 2030, which is like tomorrow, we will have 1.5 billion maybe vehicles on the road. Freight transportation is going to be increased by 30%. So for me, it's necessarily sustainable, and it's gonna be urban, mostly.
What's your point of view on that? Reality versus magic.
Oh, sustainability is a good idea. I would say also is reliability and safety. Why I'm saying that, in aviation where we are, the topic of safety is very important at the beginning. So let's imagine the transportation means we have the airplanes. You have already some level of automations, very carefully introduced step by step in the last, let's say, starting at the beginning of aviation. You had already automatic pilot coming and so on. But the big challenge now is, if we want to go further in terms of autonomy, you will have the challenge of having a very reliable systems where, let's be frank, to reduce the number of pilots in the cockpits can be a very huge challenge, because today the way to design the airplane is heavily relying on the ultimate, let's say, recourse of a pilot in case of very catastrophic issues. You can see the pilot can bring a lot. You have a nice incidents that, let's say, were solved or with a happy hand, like the Hudson River twin engine failure, that is a very famous case. You have plenty of others like this. But as soon as you have this in mind, the way to go to autonomy shall take into account all these criteria. For sure, we work on it. It's a clear driver because it's a huge cost line for the operators. It's a global topic, and we are talking about the social acceptance of 4 billion passengers every day traveling.
And we are moving through towards one pilot in the plane and maybe zero pilot in the plane. We'll get to that in a minute. Benoît Perrin, what's your view on that first question?
It's a very good question. Just to introduce Easymail very quickly, for those who don't know, we are a small company. We are 150 employees focused only on autonomous driving. So we are doing software for autonomous driving. Our first and today major product is an autonomous shuttle for 15 passengers that started 4 years ago. And the core of Easymail is really to be that we believe autonomous mobility is really a very good promise to meet the challenge of mobility and to bring a lot to the transportation. But we want to do it. There is a safety challenge that was really raised before, and the core of Easymail is to bring autonomous mobility today with the right level of safety. So we are addressing really this reality question. So we don't do things that are very crazy. We try to find use case where that we can address today with the right level of safety. And the shuttles that we are talking about today, we are targeting level of safety that are similar to the metro or to the bus, because that's what we need to reach, even better than cars. And this is really the focus. What we are trying to do is to bring transportation today with autonomous transportation today with the right level of safety.
All right, so you all talk safety, but another question I want to ask to you all and to Lasserre, why do we talk about transportation of the future? What is really disruptive about it, according to you?
The fact that we have to adapt to the people, I mean, more and more people want to travel. More and more goods are going to be transported from one place to another. And the thing is, more than just trying to optimize the transportation, I think we should think about reducing maybe, you know, only transporting what is needed. So it's a real challenge because tomorrow, when you see already that, for example, in some cities where they are banning, you know, fuel-propel engines and allowing only electric cars, that's why we need absolutely to adapt. And this is taking a range that we have never seen before.
Patrice Villiomé, what is, according to you, really disruptive about transportation of the future, and why are you so passionate about it?
I would say we have talked about autonomy, but let's take another angle and more of the opportunity we can have. Today, what I feel is that more and more we have a system of transportation means that is not really talking well to each other. You have the airline world with the aircraft, you have the city world with transportation means that are there. But at the end of the day, we need to serve collectively, let's say transportation means provider and transportation services provider, a system that is far much more efficient in terms of passenger experience, mobility in an end-to-end manner with less frictions everywhere. So I would say, the digital revolution that is appearing now is offering all these opportunities. So I listened before the topic of autonomous metro and so on. We are surely at the heart of, let's say, smart cities concept and so on. But let's imagine you extend it to airports. You extend it also to have a seamless view of your travel journey from where you are in a city to anywhere you want to go, including the air travel. Also at destination in the middle of a countryside here with the best path for you, the most efficient in terms of time, the most seamless in terms of, let's say, reducing complexity, reducing all the barriers of mobility you can have today. Imagine the number of checks you have, security check everywhere, your bags, and so on and so forth. I think this is also future of transport. We think autonomy, okay, but we need also to think to have a greater passenger experience globally to boost, let's say, this freedom.
Benoît Perrin, tell us what in your opinion is really disruptive.
I tend to agree with what the last speaking person said. I think transportation today and mobility, we are still missing an experience. There are still a lot of needs when you are living in an area with low density or far from the city center, especially, for example, Toulouse is a good example of the traffic that you have and the difficulty we are having on, every morning. Today, I think the average car transports 1.2 person on the roads. So we are still missing a lot of capacity. And what we are talking about, so autonomous vehicle is one of the answers, but connecting this vehicle, sharing this vehicle, is really the promise of having an affordable mobility door to door with the less friction as possible, connected to the other means of transportation. And we are not that far from getting that.
Just keep the mic, Benoît Perrin. You're from Easy Mile. You're a new actor of the transport. Your activity is based on electric transportation. Precisely, can you tell us how far your technologies are developed? Where do you stand precisely?
So today, our autonomous shuttles, which are indeed fully electric, we are now producing about one shuttle per week. So we are about now 80 vehicles produced. And we are finalizing the last maturity of the technology. It will be launched fully driverless on private sites, so outside of the public roads, early in 2019. And we are running tests on public roads with safety drivers since 2 years. I think it's going to be fully driverless on public roads under certain conditions, so in terms of low speed, more softer environment, probably in 2020.
What are your main challenges today? Is it how to stock the energy, for example?
On our side, it's less the electrical vehicles than the autonomous part, which is a challenge. So the real challenge is how do you bring enough features in terms of autonomous driving to have enough speed, enough capability of the cars, while ensuring and demonstrating to everybody the level of safety. So that's what we are focusing on, using technology coming from the airplane industry, from the rail industry, from the automotive industry.
Fabrice Villomé, you're from Airbus. So what's with the electrical airplane? Tell us all about this. It's just a few people here, so all you say will stay here, right? Nothing on the tweet wall. Okay. Scoop.
So I will try to tell you something. So electrical airplane, I would say it's a step-by-step process. You know, you have challenges between electricity in terms of, let's say, of capacity, in terms of reliability, in terms of power you can generate out of that. And when you see the problem of an airplane, is the best thing is to be very lighter, to have the less power as possible. So when you put all that together, we need to progress step by step on it. Let's take, for instance, the 350 program. So you had already an introduction of new way of generating the electrical power with new battery technologies in that, but it was a very huge challenge to have the right level of reliability. Or you have surely seen over experiments with small airplanes, we have an experimentation on that to go on light seaters, you know, to try to have a full, let's say, electrical small airplanes with limited autonomy of 1 hour. It's also a way to learn more. What does it mean to really perform a standard mission, you know, take off, landing, and to be more robust in that respect. So there's challenges in that area. There's clear path in terms of technologies we are looking at. But clearly, it's not for tomorrow. You will have a full, let's say, electrical-driven airplane.
Will it happen?
I would say, you know, I'm a strong believer and dreamer. I think, yes, one day it will come. But let's solve plenty of technical challenges before.
We're thinking for the next generation, maybe. Keep the mic, because your industry has to address a big issue, is to be greener. So how do you address that today, precisely?
Oh, this is very interesting. So usually we are thinking, you know, we are a huge fossil fuel consumer with the aircraft we have today. But just look at a bit the way the aircraft is operated today. We spent a lot of money, you know, to really have great aerodynamics, good integration, and so on in terms of, let's say, performance of the airplane, to have lighter structures and so on. So just look, the 350 with comparable, let's say, previous generation is something around 25% less fuel consumed. So it's not nothing for also new engine, let's say, propulsions that are more efficient. But if you look at carefully, you have plenty of inefficiencies in the way the aircraft is operated today. So we have inefficiencies in terms of delay, inefficiencies in terms of what we plan is never really flown for various reasons, due to weather, due to air traffic congestions, and so on and so forth. And very recently, we did a study that through a dynamic optimization of flight planning in an end-to-end manner, we could imagine to reduce just directly through that 5% of fuel consumptions. So it's a nice challenge, but it means to have people collaborating better together. It means to connect the airplanes, to really reforecast heavily, to have great live connectivity, to have this flight plan as they did permanently. So it's simple things, I would say. It's not a huge technological challenge, but let's make it.
And we'll talk research in a moment. Anne-Tu Lasserre, Michelin, an example of business adaptation and success. You used to be, and you still are actually, the leaders on your market, the tires. You've been drastically embracing the innovation wave. Could you tell us how precisely?
So innovation is really at the DNA of Michelin since the beginning, and still is. So we define innovation as value recognized, I mean, new value recognized by the market, so by our customers. So if we stay on the tire market, I don't know if you know, but Michelin invented the green tire at the time where oil was very cheap.
When was that?
20 years ago, right? So low resistance to rolling resistance. And at that time, people thought that we were crazy because we were spending a lot of money in research and development on that. And nowadays, it's really something that has a big value for OEMs because of the constraints they have on the CO2 emissions. So every time we can have a tire that is helping them have less consumptions, it's really a great, great value.
Can you explain how precisely is a tire greener?
Okay. So now, a tire can be greener because from the design, you can think about how you can design the tire so it can doesn't weigh as much. We are introducing also biosource materials in it. And the last point is that on the rubber side, you know, we still need natural rubber in our tires for most of them. And what we do is we have a research program to help farmers manage their plants in a way that is more sustainable, because otherwise it will turn out like oil palm. So we teach them how to alternate bananas, cocoa trees, Evia trees for the natural rubber, and so on. And a tire can be greener also because it can be less tires, meaning that since the beginning, what we're trying to do is having tires that are very performant, that can long last, so you can use it for a longer. So if you don't dismount your tire before it's really reaching the limit, you're really saving a lot of pollution, okay? And for truck tires, earth mover tires, aircraft tires, for example, what we do is we retread them 1, 2, 3, even 4 times.
Tell us, in 10 years from now, do you think we will still buy tires or we will rent them on a week base and a leasing program? What is the future?
Actually, it's already the case. If you take the aviation, a lot of contracts with the airline companies is not, we don't sell tires, we sell landings. So we actually sell a cost per landing. And for truck fleets, we sell miles instead of tires, so it's a cost per mile. And for earth mover, in the big mines, it's tons per kilometer. We already have that type of contracts.
And what precisely is changing for you and your activity when we talk autonomous vehicle? What does it imply for Michelin today?
Okay, autonomous vehicles, I think one of the things that was a little bit surprising is that autonomous vehicles don't detect too well the potholes. You know, you can detect, a passenger crossing a vehicle in front of you, but if the road has potholes, it doesn't detect that well. So it's really a requirement for the tire now to be more robust, because if you look at the roads you have today and the maintenance of them, it's getting pretty bad, especially in Asia. So that's one of the things that is giving us a leading edge, because we are capable with our technologies to have tires that are more resistant to that kind of shocks.
Let's talk research, ladies and gentlemen. Benoît Perrin, maybe a word on research. What are you currently exploring in terms of material, maybe?
In terms of material today, we're working with partners, especially on battery systems. It's always the same story with the battery: how to get more energy stored in a certain space, in a certain weight. Today, for example, our shuttles can last for a day with one night of charging, but now we have clients, they want to operate 24-hour day, and then they need to recharge quickly to have like a 15-minute recharge, and the level of technology is not, we don't have yet the battery technology that is really adapted to that, so we work with battery manufacturers around that. We are also looking at hydrogen, although it's going to take, I think, a longer time to get there.
There is something that has been tried in aeroport, not far from here, with the hydrogen battery, I think, at Tarbes, something like
that's
that,
good.
Isn't it, with plane, I think? Just one question, do you work with labs or do you have your own research center?
For materials, and we work with battery manufacturers mostly, because we are more of a software company, so we do most of our research into software. For all the material and mechanical parts, we work with partners. It's not our main area of expertise. We have especially strong partnership with Continental for all the software, the components and material components.
Patrice, Villomé, Antula Serre just mentioned biosource material. Tell us, what is Airbus currently developing in terms of future materials?
Same answer than electricity. I'm not an expert in materials, also too, so.
No, but just a word on the research, maybe.
Yeah, no, the basic focus is really, really, as usual, on lighter materials for the airframe, because you have a direct impact between, let's say, the fuel consumptions we have and the weight of the airframe. So all what is related to new carbon fiber approach and materials in that spectrum, new resins. So for instance, there's very, very nice things popping up here and there in more resistance, lighter resins actually, that can reduce by 30, 40% the way to manufacture some panels and so on, is one very good example of priority where we are looking at.
And to the same question, what is currently Michelin working on in terms of research for the future of transportation?
In terms of materials or?
Materials, anything, okay. Research.
Research. Maybe two things. The first one is that more and more, I mean, regarding sustainable mobility, because we're a mobility company, we're not a tire company, not only. So we are animating since years and years a community of open innovation and also putting together public, private entities, the cities. So I don't know if you've heard about Moving On, which is the... Okay. So Moving On, which is really the worldwide summit on sustainable mobility. Before that, it was called the Challenge Bibendum. So we changed the name 2 years ago to make it more, I guess, less related to Michelin, but because we people think we're legitimate to animate that kind of community. So that's for really the open innovation. And also in our research and development programs, we have more and more partnerships with startups, with academics, and that's really a big trend because we don't think that alone we can solve the challenges in front of us.
So this year's CWIN motto is artificial intelligence squares. So the question I want to address to the three of you is, what is artificial intelligence role in your activity currently and in the future?
It's big part of what we do today. We're using different technologies of artificial intelligence. We are using computer vision and we are using deep learning. It's going to be part of the solution for autonomous vehicle for sure to have some kind of deep learning. We are obviously classifying the obstacles, for example, using neural networks. We are also looking at the navigation, also with deep learning. Our belief in EasyMile is, maybe in contrast to some others in the industry, is that artificial intelligence is not going to be the only answer, and artificial in and by itself is not going to solve everything. It can do very nice things, but the main thing is safety. When is the neural network not working? Today, the neural network cannot answer that it is not working. So the domain area needs to be, you need to have a monitoring of the neural networks. So we need to add some other technology to that. But clearly, I mean, artificial intelligence is a major core of our development. And we're working not alone because that's a huge investment to build the neural network, to train them, to simulate and everything. But it's core of the EasyMile technology.
How many people are working for EasyMile today?
150, and so it's almost only R&D engineers. So we have PhDs and software engineers.
Are you currently looking for people? Are you hiring?
Yes, we are recruiting.
Okay, so
candidates,
go ahead.
Especially in these technologies, I mean, computer vision, robotics, deep learning, both in France and in Singapore.
All right. Patrice Villomé, artificial intelligence, what is Airbus currently addressing?
I would say it's interesting just to step back to 2 seconds. We implemented in onboard software some neural network computing. It was certified in 2007 for the first time in some automatic braking intelligence functions on VA380. So it's interesting to see we started a bit like what you are doing more on the automatic control of the vehicle per se. But now with the launch of the, perhaps you've heard about the new open data platform we have launched called Skywise just more than a year ago. I would say now systematically with the fact we have this platform connecting aircraft more or less every day, swallowing all the systems data massively, but also combining that with data coming from the operations of the airlines, from us as designer of the aircraft, we can employ AI in various aspects of the operations. So it can start, for instance, from looking at the reliability of the fleet and identifying and anticipating, let's say, risk of failure of a component or subcomponent of the airplane, and to be more proactive in the maintenance of the aircraft, so a kind of road of more availability at the end of the day.
You mean you're already doing this?
Yes, we have started to do that and to deliver these first algorithms and approach for this. Another example on which we are working is more on, let's say, demonstration area. It's you can use AI approach for image processing to identify damages on composite materials, for instance, that could be interesting to ease the life of a mechanic, you know, at the gate. When there's something happening, it's very hard to identify if the issue is impacting the airworthiness of the aircraft and if you can continue to fly. We really think the usage of that with simple mobile device in it will help a lot with decision making and at the end of the day allow to fly more the airplane and instead to stop that. So there's plenty of, area where you can use AI. Also natural language processing is another area where you can realize that today you have plenty of information exchanged by voice in the flight of operation. And at the end of the day, the guys are using their pen and pencils and you have mistakes everywhere. So if we could automate that into very easy applications to ease the life of pilot and controllers is an area, a straightforward route. So there's plenty of, of example where AI can be very useful. We are exploring systematically around the airline operations, but also moving step by step to the airport operations world and passenger experience.
And tu la sais, what is the impact on Michelin's activity of AI?
So we're starting to use AI, again, back to the definition, that is the moving definition. So in our operations, in the industry, of course, but if you go back to transportation, I would say that, for example, one example of AI on the field is that we are putting sensors into the mining tires, and we're able to help the mine optimize the number of rotations, if they have more loads, for example, because we know the impact on the performance and how long it can be, the tire can last. So we're helping them optimize using machine learning algorithms.
Are you actually looking for skills in AI?
Yes, of course.
I'll ask the same question to Airbus. What kind of skills are you looking for, precisely?
Maybe data engineers.
Data engineers.
And also data scientists, of course.
Same question to Airbus.
I would say same answer. And also, it's a way we organize the things because the use cases are just the limits of that is our brain. So I would say if we would like to explore everything, we need to have skillful people in teams to do that. So we are looking at various ways of organizing that. So it means also footprints, where you go to demonstrate and industrialize these applications. It's also the way to recruit people. Sometimes it's not so easy to have that. It's also to use open innovation approach, as you are doing, I'm sure, to identify and scout nice startups or small companies that can have a really relevant use case in an adjacent market we could, reuse in a way or apply in our world. So it's all that approaches are quite key because the fastest of the essence to really solve problems to our customers.
All right, we're almost reaching the end of this table round roundtable, another 5 minutes to go. So I'm looking at the audience to see if there are some questions for our speakers. Go ahead and take your chance because we don't have that casting every morning here available for you. Are there questions? I have other questions, but are there some questions in the audience? Yes, back there. Maybe you can stand up and try to talk loud if possible. Do we really want that? Question.
Our first question is that we need to make sure we can make it. But let's look a bit at the natural trends. Step back a bit. In the year 70s, 80s, you had three pilots in the cockpit. We introduced two pilots in the cockpit. Thanks to the fly-by-wire system we introduced on the 320, it was 87, okay? So now we are in the years, let's say, close to 2020. I would say the next challenge, natural stuff, is how to reduce the number of crew in some specific operations to move to two or reinforce crews. You know, sometimes on route, you have up to four crews on board when you have long routes. To reduce the number of guys on duty on board to 4-3 or 3-2 or 2-1 in crews in particular. So this is the next big step. I would say this, technologically speaking, you could say we could start in the coming 3-5 years, but the big deal will be the social acceptance of that.
Well, first on the short distance flight, maybe.
Longer one. Because look, the where you have the heaviest cost of crews is on the longer route. So because you need to reinforce crews, and at the end of the day, you have one takeoff and one landing. So if you need four pilots, it's a bit crazy. So you can see the trend there, and after that, you have the full, let's say, single pilot operation. So one pilot alone, you know, in an airplane and assisted from the ground. Here is a huge challenge in terms of certificability of that approach, because it comes back to, I would say, we are ruining absolutely all the principle of certifying an airplane. So we have to revamp absolutely the way to certify an airplane. And after that, you have the full zero pilot on board. But just the step of one pilot in the cockpit, it might be in 30 years, potentially. And after that, I don't know.
Okay, let's make a test. Who's ready to take an airplane with no pilot on board? Oh, okay. There are a few people. All right.
No,
okay.
Just
keep the mic, Fabrice, because I want to ask you a question on urban mobility. Is urban mobility a priority for Airbus? Do you invest in it? Well, maybe we can talk a little bit about the project ANA.
Oh, I would say yes. Very recently, you have potentially see that in our communication, we have structuring in ourselves with a dedicated team reporting to our CEO on the urban air mobility to, let's say, streamline also a bit series of initiatives we had. You are mentioning VANA, but we had also over with VOOM, for example, with Airbus helicopters and so on. Because for us, urban air mobility moves back to what is our mission as Airbus at the end of the day. Long period of time, it was to provide, let's say, airplanes of various natures, so rotorcraft, fixed-wing airplane, and so on. But at the end of the day, we do that for a certain purpose, is to ease mobility for the passenger. So when you look at the challenges of mobility around between cities and urban area, we are facing that through our helicopters division. So I would say a natural trend is to move to urban drones to transport people in those areas. And immediately, you can imagine a kind of seamless air system that we could create because we are present in platform for sure, but we are also present in services to operate, to design airspaces in that respect too. So we have more or less key skills to move in that direction.
One question, and I will ask the same to Benoît Perrin, because Antu Lasserre almost answered to that. Now, keep the mic. What is, according to you, the business model of the future of transportation? Is it to rent? Is it to own?
I don't know if you know the structure of our customers today. Basically, more than 50-55% of the aircraft we are delivering today are owned by lessors. So they are purchasing the airplane and selling through fees or dry lease or wet lease. It depends on the level of services you have linked to that, to the operators. So So already we are moving from a traditional ownership of an airplane to something that is more on a usage, let's say, per usage, let's say, approach. What I feel is that we'll move more and more on something that is well known by Michelin, for instance, or in other parties, it's a fly by the hour services or a kind of performance guarantee services. So we start to have some services in the area for, let's say, the spares and the repairs you need to ensure the continuity of the operation. But if you put all that together, we are not so far to have a kind of seat mile business model, or to have a kind of number of people you can transport in a given period of time. So this is at reach.
Anne-Thu Lasserre, a quick note on the...
I think we're clearly moving to mobility as a service. Intermodal, meaning that if I need to go from point A to point B, I don't need to own all the transportation, whether it's the plane, a bicycle, a metro. So clearly, we're moving more and more toward that kind of business model.
Benoît Perrin, what business model?
The politically correct answer is that it's going to be shared mobility and therefore mobility as a service. I think if we want to solve the challenge of mobility, urban mobility especially, or with lower density but close to urban, we need to share, because it's not achievable at a reasonable cost to have each of us having their own mobility device. So we need to solve this having just 1.2% per car. We need to go to shared mobility and therefore mobility as a service. And autonomous mobility make it easier for that. This said, we did some tests with partners on actually there is autonomous mobility. There is a way to test it as it is. It could be in 5 years today, is to give to a family a car with a driver. It's like having autonomous mobility in a way. It's not just a driver. So we did that with one of our partners for 1 week. We gave to a family a car with a driver, and they loved it so much that they are using the car almost 100% of the time. So between sending the car to get the kids at school, sending the car to get a package, sending the cars, and it was fully booked. So there is still, I think, potential for individual car market, even in an autonomous car market.
Thank you. I would like to welcome Patrice Dubuis for maybe a wrap-up on this roundtable. Just a couple words. What is your lecture?
Okay, thank you. First of all, thanks to all the speakers. Why transportation? Because when we are in Toulouse, transportation means Airbus. But I wanted to link transportation and diversity. Diversity is not only a matter of gender. It's not only male and female. Diversity is also junior and seniors. And in transportation, it means multimodal. Because as a passenger, our traveling experience is end-to-end, from our home to destination. So even if we are taking an aircraft, we need to go to the airport and from the airport to destination. So it's interesting to see what we can do on Earth with train, with Val. And I'm not sure that you were aware that we've got so many competencies in France and in Toulouse. Hearing of Frederic with Val and Siemens, with EasyMile, with Antu, with Michelin as a new business model. And so I see three major commonalities in all your business. First of all is new business model. So how we need to change. The second thing is sustainability. Because everybody now is aware that we need to take care of the planet. And we speak a lot of new means of energy. So we could speak also about EDF. They will make a major announcement around transportation and hydrogen. I don't know, Muriel, if we can say a word. Not yet. Okay, so you will come back later. And the third thing, I forget.
Safety, maybe?
It was not safety. It was energy, business model, never mind.
We'll come back.
The idea is, it was AI, of course, because when we speak about innovation, we see that AI will influence a lot what will be the transportation of the future. So that was the reason why this round table, and thanks again to Frédéric, Benoît, Antu, and Fabrice.
Yeah, please give a warm thanks to all the speakers. Thank you.